The other day, I was watching a Netflix documentary where the rapper Killer Mike was having a conversation with a well-known pastor of a mega church. And Killer Mike says to him, "I don't want to worship no white Jesus." To my surprise, this well-known pastor says nothing to Killer Mike to refute or correct Killer Mike's assumption that Jesus' heritage or ethnicity was that of European Anglo-Saxon descent. Nevertheless, what I thought was more important is that this pastor did not explain to Killer Mike that Jesus' nationality, color, or ethnicity, or what he looked like is immaterial. But who he truly is what truly matters to all. He is the Son of God who came into the world to grant grace and forgiveness to all who believe in him. To me, that's apologetics 101. But that is not to say that the portrayal and depiction of Jesus proliferated in modern times as a Western European Anglo-Saxon does not have a negative effect in the minds of people, because it does. Whether a person is a believer in Christ or not, Jesus is the world's most renowned person. The greatest event in human history was the coming of Jesus into this world. The greatest words ever spoken were his words. The greatest deeds ever done were accomplished by his hands. Jesus stands alone in all history, the single most significant person who ever lived. And the use of his image, race, and ethnicity for political and social advantage has had a huge effect on the minds of people, both those who want to promote their ethnic heritage as superior and those who have been subjugated as somehow inferior because of their ethnicity and race. So it's understandable why Killer Mike said what he said. However, the problem with Killer Mike's thinking is that it actually perpetuates the propaganda which he claims to oppose. Why? Because his position actually shows he believes what this world has told him about Yeshua HaMashiach, or Jesus the Christ, which causes him not to believe in the only one that can grant him salvation. Ignorant. Let's proceed. I don't say ignorant in a demeaning way. I say it in the actual definition of the word. Destitute of knowledge or education, lacking knowledge or comprehension of the thing, resulting from a showing of lack of knowledge or intelligence, unaware, uninformed. As a middle-aged African-American, I grew up with the depiction of Jesus being portrayed as a European Anglo-Saxon. I also heard all of the Christianity is a white man's religion, the white man used the Bible to enslave black people, and all the other propaganda and rhetoric about Christianity and the Bible. However, even as a young man, before coming to know Yeshua HaMashiach, or Jesus the Christ as my Lord and Savior, there was something in me that made me know that if there was a God, to him, color of skin was not an issue. So I reserved judgment on the issue of Jesus' ethnicity or color because I did not know. I was ignorant. 2 Corinthians 4:4, "In whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them." Blindness is a synonym of ignorance. Ignorance is to be blinded to something or to the truth of something. The very word used in 2 Corinthians 4:4 for blindness signifies ignorance. The word is tuflao, which means to blow smoke which causes clouded vision, to blunt mental discernment, darken the mind, keep a person ignorant to the truth. Satan, who is called the god of this world, the prince of the power of the air, meaning he controls and promotes the propaganda in this world. He uses ethnicity and race as a weapon to promote his goal to deceive and keep many people ignorant, blinded to the truth of God and his work of salvation. As a master deceiver and manipulator, Satan knows that man is easily manipulated into operating on outward appearances, which promotes biases and prejudices based solely on obvious outward appearance of a person's ethnicity and general physical characteristics, such as skin tone. These categorizations bring about divisiveness, discord, biases, segregation, discrimination, prejudice, and hatred based solely on skin color and ancestry. Satan clearly uses these flawed methods of judgment of a person to bring about his purpose. It is but an easy thing for Satan to blind the minds of man to the nature of Yahshua HaMashiach, or Jesus the Christ, by getting them to judge the outward appearance based on perceived ethnicity and race, keeping them ignorant to the truth of salvation.
Scripture is clear. Judging one another by our status, gender, race, or ethnicity is not only unbiblical and unsound, but clearly opposed to the message of the gospel. God's message of salvation to all is clear. Ethnic prejudice is morally reprehensible. Satan is about deception, and outward appearances for judgment is an easy tool for him to use. We still have people trying to judge Jesus by outward appearance. White, black, Latino, etc. Is this not judgment of outward appearance? How many people are deceived and disillusioned by Yeshua HaMashiach not being black or white, Latino, Chinese, Arab, Indian, or European, only to concern themselves about his outward appearance because they're shallow, have no depth of character, only to base a Messiah on man and the devil's representation of him and miss the truth of his true beauty? Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. I've heard many African Americans say Christianity is the white man's religion, used to keep slaves under control, that the oppressor always subjugates those to whom they oppress with their religion. Now here's the flawed logic in that. 1. Judaism existed tens of thousands of years before any European country truly came into existence. 2. The Torah and the prophets, which all prophesied about the coming Christ, existed tens of thousands of years before European countries truly came into existence. 3. And most importantly, the New Testament not only has its origin in the Middle East, but was written almost 1,800 years before the United States became a country and slavery instituted. So if it's the white man's religion, what was it before the white man came into power? Better yet, why are the origins of the Bible, Judaism, and Christianity from regions of the world where the people are primarily people of color? You see the flawed, shallow logic in that reasoning?
Let's look at a passage that I believe dispels the issue of race when it comes to Yahshua HaMashiach, or Jesus the Christ. Acts chapter 8, verses 26 through 39. Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Go south to the road, the desert road, that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza." So he started out, and on his way he met an Ethiopian eunuch, an important official in charge of all the treasury of the Kandak, which means Queen of the Ethiopians. This man had gone down to Jerusalem to worship, and on his way home was sitting in his chariot reading the book of Isaiah the prophet. The Spirit told Philip, "Go to that chariot and stay near it." Then Philip ran up to the chariot and heard the man reading Isaiah the prophet. "Do you understand what you are reading?" Philip asked. "How can I," he said, "unless someone explains it to me." So he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. This is a passage of scripture the eunuch was reading. "He was led like a sheep to slaughter, and as a lamb before its shear is silent, so he did not open his mouth. In his humiliation, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of his descendants? For his life was taken from the earth." The eunuch asked Philip, "Tell me, please, who is the prophet talking about, himself or someone else?" Then Philip began with that very passage of scripture and told him the good news about Jesus. As they traveled along the road, they came to some water. The eunuch said, "Look, here is water. What can stand in the way of my being baptized?" And he gave orders to stop the chariot. Then both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord suddenly took Philip away, and the eunuch did not see him again, but went on his way rejoicing. What do we see in this story? 1. He was of Ethiopian descent, meaning he was black. That's what Ethiopian means. It means burnt or dark skin. 2. He was a distinguished gentleman, an important man. He had some influence and wealth. 3. He had some education, especially for that day, because he could read and he had scripture. Many people were unable to have their own books at the time, even if they could read. That was mainly for the upper class. And 4. Philip was not of his race, creed, or countrymen. However, Philip saw and heard a man who is not his countryman, not his skin color, was not a Jew, appeared to have wealth, prestige, and honor, and none of that mattered to Philip. And more importantly, neither did it matter to the Ethiopian. All Philip saw and heard was a man whose heart wanted to know the good news of Jesus. The Ethiopian didn't question what color Jesus was, how Jesus looked, what Jesus' job was, or anything outward. The Ethiopian simply saw in the scriptures the beauty and desirableness of the prophet, Yahshua HaMashiach, or Jesus the Christ, the Messiah, spoken of in those passages, which caused his heart to desire to know Jesus. Most importantly, God saw what was in the Ethiopian's heart, and he sent Philip over to him to expound more clearly on the Messiah. Philip explained to the Ethiopian the passage was talking about Jesus. The Ethiopian received the testimony of truth about Jesus, so much so he was willing to accept a ritual practice that was foreign to him, water baptism. He even told Philip, verse 36, as they traveled along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "Look, here is water. What can stand in the way of me being baptized?" Had the Ethiopian been concerned with the exterior, outward appearance, he could have never believed in Jesus as the Savior of the world, the Lamb of God, the great I Am. It is with the heart one believes. It is but the ignorance of outward appearance proliferated that blinds the minds of people. But the problem is not being ignorant. The problem is not seeking the truth and purposely remaining blind. With all of that being said, the Bible does reference Jesus, Yahshua, with the skin color of burnished brass or bronze, which some may say is symbolic. Symbolic of what? They never say. But I do know the depiction of Jesus with Western Anglo-Saxon features, which is most often portrayed, is completely inaccurate. Yet that does not mean he was African looking either. Latinos portray Jesus looking Latino. Asians tend to depict Jesus looking more Asian. And I'm sure other races tend to make Jesus look more like them. In 2015, Esquire magazine reported a photo created by British and Israeli archaeologists using forensic anthropological technology to create what is to believe the most accurate image of the most famous face in human history. The forensic anthropological picture shows a man with bronze skin, with a round nose, short beard, and distinctly looks of Middle Eastern descent. While it's by no means a full confirmation, it seems to assert the popular assessment by many scholars that Jesus would resemble the Middle Eastern population based on the geographical location of his birth and life. But does it really matter that we know the color of Jesus' skin, whether he was black, yellow, brown, or white? Though this may be a controversial issue for some, the truth is that it shouldn't matter what the color of Jesus' skin was. Scripture provides little, if any, description of what Jesus really looked like. So why is there this overall concern about what Jesus looked like? His physical makeup, whether he was this skin tone or that skin tone. An obvious answer is outward appearance. Controversies, quarrels, and arguments brought about by the prince of the power of the air that blinds the minds and dulls the senses. God's word tells us in 1 Samuel 16:7, "But the Lord said to Samuel, 'Do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him.' The Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." One thing that has always been clear to me since I've been saved, if it were important for us to know what Jesus really looked like, Matthew, Peter, John, and the other disciples who spent over 3.5 years with him almost daily, and Jesus' brothers, James and Jude, would have certainly given us an accurate description of what Jesus looked like, some description of his appearance, his physical attributes. Yet scripture offers no details about Jesus' physical attributes or makeup. So if it were that important, then God would have told us about it. However, what the Bible does tell us in Isaiah 53:2 about the physical appearance of Jesus was that he was not physically attractive. He grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. Nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. Jesus came into this world a peasant, obscure, unattractive, which appeared from the outward nothing that man should desire. But it was for that very express purpose God made him so that those who could not hear or see would say, "Isn't this the carpenter? Isn't this Mary's son and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon?" aren't his sisters here with us? And they took offense at him. But it's also for the purpose of those who could see and hear with their hearts would know who he was. It was not his beauty of form man was to desire, but it was the beauty of his expression of life and godliness that man was to see. God purposely disappointed the senses of man as to the Messiah, making his true identity visible only to the discerning eye of faith to distinguish who he is, the Hamashiach or Messiah, all of which has absolutely nothing to do with the way he looks or the color of his skin. So again, why the controversy surrounding Jesus' ethnicity and race? 1 Timothy 1:4. To devote themselves to myths and endless genealogies, such things promote controversial speculations rather than advancing God's work, which is by faith. Titus 3:9. But avoid foolish controversies and genealogies and arguments and quarrels. The Greek word for genealogies is genealogia, which means lineage, descent, ethnicity. Listen to what these scriptures tell us about concerning ourselves with ethnicity or color. It only promotes controversies. Foolish controversies, speculations, and arguments. The Lord is not concerned with the outward appearance and shows no favoritism towards the outward appearance of man, but accepts all people of every nation, creed, or color who accept his gift of salvation. Are you looking for the right Hamashiach, the Lord and Savior of the world? Would you recognize him if he appeared to you? Scripture shows us that Jesus can appear to us in whatever form he chooses, black or white, Latino or Hebrew, Chinese or Korean. The question is, would you recognize him? Jesus is a great many things to a great many people, but one thing he is not, and that is some external outward person you want to revere. You don't have to know what he looked like to know him, and he looks for those to worship him in spirit and in truth. Then you will see Jesus. May God bless and keep you, my friends, in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen.
Thank you for tuning in to Fellowship in the Word. If you've been blessed by this video, please click the subscribe button and the bell to receive notification of when we upload new videos. Thank you, and God bless you.